And welcome to Park Central Church today. If it's the first time you've seen our YouTube channel, or if it's the first time watching one of our videos, my name is David, and I'm thrilled that you've managed to find our church and joined us for today's service. We'd love to keep in touch with you, so please leave a comment saying hi, or connect with us on Facebook or Instagram. And just a quick note to say that in a few moments we're going to be having communion, so if you've got a few minutes, so just go and grab some bread and some juice, so we can all take part together and do what Jesus commanded us to do. Remember him until he comes again. So, December is here. Finally. It's been a long year, I'm sure you'd agree. It's now perfectly acceptable to put your decorations up and listen to Christmas music. Although this year, you can get away with being judged too harshly if you trimmed up in October. That's all fine. I've been listening to Christmas music for the last couple of months. In fact, I remember when I was still off on paternity leave, S and I, we took the kids for a walk and we saw two houses next to each other. One covered in pumpkins and lanterns and ghosts and silly string everywhere. And the other, its next door neighbour, Christmas lights, a Santa Stop Here sign and a tree in the window. And this was the middle of October. But I love Christmas. I love the lights. I love the fact that everything looks pretty. I love that these weeks that we're in now, they build up to something. And that it seems to be a unifying time of the year. It seems that most people, I'd say the majority of people, are excited and expectant. You know, this period of building up and leading towards something. And for some, that's the giving and the receiving of gifts and presents. For some, it's food, the ability to eat and drink whatever you want over a period of a few days and looking forward to that magnificent Christmas Day dinner. For others, it's just to enjoy time being off work and spending some time with friends and family. But for me, it's the build-up to the birth of a baby, a child, a son. The child of a human woman, the son of a king. You know, the saying, Jesus is the reason for the season, is 100% true. We celebrate the birth of a baby who is God in human form, who was sent to this earth to fulfill God the Father's plan, to die on a cross as a perfect being, sinless, so that he could take on his shoulders all of my sin, all of your sin, the sin of the whole world, past, present, and future, in order to make a way and bridge that separation between us and God. Absolutely incredible. And if that's not worth celebrating, then nothing is. Christmas is not cancelled, despite the rumours, despite what you've read on Facebook. Christmas is not cancelled. Christmas cannot be cancelled, because in my world, Christmas is a person who is God, and a person who is everlasting. And that is who we are remembering today when we eat, you know, this bread, and when we drink this juice, we are remembering the body and blood of Jesus that was broken and poured out on that cross for you and for me. We remember the suffering and the death, but we also remember the incredible love that was demonstrated by that act, and the new life that we have been offered and given as a free gift because of the cross. It says in Matthew 6 that Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." And then he took a cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." God, I thank you that you love us so much that you sent your son Jesus to be born on the earth to die. That you cared enough and desired a relationship with me to the extent that you would do that. I ask for forgiveness for all the wrong things that I have done, and thank you that you forgive freely and you forgive without limit. May I never forget the price that you paid for me. I'm so grateful and I'm so thankful. Help me to love you more and more each day. Amen.
Oh, can you hear the angel song that rang so sweet and clear? When heaven's light and music fell and mercy found us here. Glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace. Glory to God, the angels sing. He came to tell the Father's love, His goodness and His grace. To show the brightness of His smile, the glory of His face. So glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace. Glory to God, your children sing. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. Burdens and to give a glorious gift. So glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace. Glory to God, the world will sing. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor.
Isaiah 9 verse 6 says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder,
and his name shall be called Wonderful Counsellor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Amen. So over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be looking at that verse, and in particular, the names that prophet Isaiah ascribes to the child that he's talking about. Isaiah writes, his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. So over the course of December, we're going to take one of those names and explore it and unpack it in a little bit more detail. And we're going to look at them in the order that they were written. So the title of today's message is quite simply, his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. But before we get to the actual text, we need to really set the scene and try to understand what's going on at the time that God spoke this through the prophet Isaiah. So we're about 700 years before Jesus was born here, and the world is in a bit of a crisis, to be honest. In fact, it's a complete mess. And, you know, this isn't the prophecy that was given at Christmas time, where everybody's happy and there's lovely music being played and people are exchanging gifts and eating turkey. Although I'm sure the words chaos and complete mess can be used to describe some of your Christmas Day experiences. But the situation here in Israel was dire, and there was a very real threat of invasion and war, and King Ahaz, who was the king of Judah, he was facing an attack really from the Assyrians, and he didn't know what to do. He didn't know whether to form an alliance with somebody else, or he didn't know who to side with. He wanted the best for his people, but in that moment he just wasn't sure what course of action would be best. So God sent Isaiah the prophet to Ahaz to tell him, right, Ahaz, don't worry about it. Don't worry about the other nations. Don't worry about forming alliances. Don't worry about any of that stuff. God will protect you. But Isaiah could tell that that didn't really cause Ahaz to stop worrying. So he told Ahaz that God would give him a sign that everything was going to be okay. But again, that didn't really help Ahaz out. He didn't want a sign because he felt that if God gave him a sign, then he would be obligated to have to obey that sign. And he didn't really want to put that to the test, really. So Isaiah told Ahaz that God said not to worry about things because he's got it all in control. That didn't really work with Ahaz. So Isaiah said, all right, God will give you a sign to prove to you that I'm not messing with you, or that God isn't messing with you, and he really has got it under control. And that didn't work either. So Isaiah is now like, well, God's going to give you a sign anyway, whether you like it or not, a sign is coming regardless. And then we get to Isaiah chapter 7, verses 14. And the sign is this. It says, therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Okay, so what exactly is Ahaz going to do with this sign? How is this prophecy of a baby that will be born in 7 centuries time in the future, how will that help or give comfort to King Ahaz and Israel in the immediate present, when he's got real difficulty, he's got trouble staring him right in his face, there's an army outside waiting to attack? How does this sign help in any way, shape or form? And I guess King Ahaz and a lot of people today, you know, especially around Christmas time, have similar feelings. They feel the same way. We like the idea of a little baby born in a stable with shepherds that followed a bright star that led them there. And all the kids get dressed up and they do these little shows, and they've got towels on their head and old curtains wrapped around them, singing nice songs. It's all very nice and quaint, but seriously, I've got real problems, I've got real issues. How is this story about Jesus going to help my marriage, or help me find a job, or put dinner on the table, or put money in my bank account, or improve my health? What is the point in this sign? What's the point in Jesus? Firstly, in sending Jesus, God is dealing with our problems at its root. You know, we might think our problems are to do with our health or to do with our finances, or they are relationship issues. Ahaz might have thought that his problem was the army that he was facing or the war that he was going to have to fight. But the root of all of our problems is separation from God. All of the problems, the real problems that we face, ultimately stem back to that separation. And please, please don't misunderstand me here. I'm not saying that anybody's being punished for any specific sin that's been committed or in fact for anything that you or I have done. But if God were to take away all of our earthly problems without fixing the root problem, then all we would do is just create new problems for ourselves. You know, the root problem, the root cause of everything is that we were born separated from God. We are all born with that problem, so we all need fixing. So God, as a sign to Ahaz, told him that rather than fix the problem that you can see in front of you, that God is going to fix the root of your problems. He promised to send a Messiah that would save us from our sins, and not just from our enemies, but he would transform our hearts. You know, we want to be delivered from bad health, but God wants to deliver us from the curse of death that causes bad health. We want to be delivered from, you know, broken relationships or issues that we have with people, but God wants to deliver us from the selfishness that breaks those relationships. You know, we want to be victorious in our battles. We want to overcome things, but God has promised a Messiah that would take away that desire or take away that drive to win battles or to have enemies or to cause conflict and to force us to be in a position to win or to lose. And then secondly, Isaiah goes on to describe four names of the Messiah that would change how we relate to God, which leads us onto this morning's name, Wonderful Counselor. You know, it's one phrase, it's not two separated by a comma, if that's in your Bible. It's not wonderful, then Counselor. Isaiah calls the Messiah Wonderful Counselor. Pele Yohaz is the Hebrew. Pele, meaning beyond understanding. You know, we say that about Christmas time, that it's the most wonderful time of the year. But this word Pele literally means that there are no words to describe how awesome he is. The word is so much greater than our use of the word wonderful today. You know, I had a wonderful lemon cake yesterday, but I didn't have a Pele lemon cake. And there's a beautiful parallel here to the story of Samson's birth in Judges 13. Manoah and his wife, they were unable to have kids, and an angel appeared to the wife and said, "You're going to get pregnant, you're going to have a son." And Manoah prayed that the angel would return again so that he could ask him some questions and that the angel could teach and instruct them how to raise this child. And it says that God heard the prayer of Manoah and the angel returned. And Manoah was desperate to know more about the angel and wanted to give it a gift. He wanted to give it some food or an offering. And then in verse 17, it says, "Then Manoah inquired of the angel of the Lord, 'What is your name, so that we may honor you when your word comes true?'" And verse 18 says, "He replied, 'Why do you ask my name? It is beyond understanding.'" The same word here for wonderful, beyond understanding. God, the angel of God, so God in this form that appeared before Manoah, said that his name was wonderful, that his name was beyond understanding. We cannot grasp the goodness of God. We cannot name him appropriately because there are no names worthy enough. He is completely and utterly beyond understanding because he is so powerful, so mighty, so incredible, so awesome, but more importantly, so much, much more than that. So that's Pele, and then Yohaz. And it just means counselor. It just means to counsel or to advise, to guide, to instruct. But there's an important distinction here, that this word means that you counsel or you instruct from a position of authority. And later on in Isaiah 11, we read, "There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from its roots shall bear fruit, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. So there can be no doubt that Isaiah in chapter 9 is talking about Jesus. He's not talking about anyone else. He's not talking about any other baby or any other birth. He is referring specifically and directly to the Messiah, God in human flesh, the Saviour of the world. So, this counsellor, this wonderful counsellor, isn't like the other counsellors or other counsellors that we think of today. You know, you're probably thinking of marriage counsellors or guidance counsellors, addiction counsellors, or even in the legal world, you know, some solicitors and barristers are presented as legal counsellors. I worked at a summer camp in America, and my job title was camp counsellor. You know, these are people who we expect to help us, to give good advice, to be a good sounding board for things that we're going through, to provide some insight into our lives, as well as some tips, really, to move forward. Also, the word counsel, generally refers to a body or a group of people who are wise, that have been brought together to guide and instruct, that they are maybe known in their field or they're experts, and they have the ability to advise others going forward. And this is what our definition or understanding of a counsellor is. I'm sure you'd agree with me. But also, counsellors, they're not always available. You know, they have hours that they work. They often charge a fee, can be quite expensive, I understand. They're also not always right. You know, just because you book an appointment and pay somebody a ridiculous hourly fee, it doesn't mean that you're getting good advice or good counsel. And let's go back to the very beginning of the Bible. In Genesis 3, it's clear that Satan counseled Eve, and she and Adam disobeyed the Lord. We, humankind, mankind, has listened to the wrong counselor. But Jesus, as our counselor, is always available. He says in Matthew 28, "And surely I am with you always too." And then in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, God says, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." He never changes. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And one of the things I guess people would look for before deciding on who to go to for counselling would be, well, what qualifies them? You know, what are their qualifications? Why should I trust their advice and guidance? What have they achieved, and what's their experience levels like? In Hebrews 4, verses 15 and 16, it says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. He is able to sympathize with our weaknesses." He's been there. He's done it. He knows. Jesus has been tempted, it says, in every way, just as we are. He understands us. He is completely relevant to us today. He's not out of touch. There is no new sin. There is no new temptation. And because he has been there, he has done it all, nothing that can touch us hasn't been experienced by him. So we can go to him with confidence because he has the answers. He is qualified. He has the experience. And he says he then gives us mercy and grace. And mercy is basically God not giving us what we deserve, and grace then is God giving us what we don't deserve. You know, this wonderful counselor is ready. He's ready right now, ready all of the time to help us in our time of need. And there's three verbs or I guess actions that tend to happen when you seek counsel from somebody. Simple things that we can all do, but so very often don't. And firstly, talk. Jesus wants us to talk to him. He wants us to open up, to tell him how we are, but not just talk around the subject or play things down. We can and should be brutally honest with Jesus. You know, if you're in absolute agony and you feel like you're in so much pain that you can't cope anymore, you ring the doctors or you go online now, you book an appointment, you go and sit down in the doctor's office and they ask you how you are and what's the matter. And you respond by saying, nothing really, I'm fine, I've just got a little pain in my shoulder, but you know, honestly, it's not too bad. Really, I think I can cope with it. Then what's going to happen? You know, the doctor might give you some mild painkillers and just send you out of there. The doctor can't help you if you don't tell them what's wrong. And I mean specifically what's wrong. Exactly where it hurts, how much it hurts, how did it happen, where did the problem come about? What got you to this point? And the funny thing with Jesus is, he knows anyway. But he wants us to talk to him. He wants us to tell him stuff. So tell him everything. Tell him how you're really feeling deep, deep down. There's a story in John where Jesus is alone at a well and a woman comes to collect some water on her own in the middle of the day. And Jesus talks to her and asks her for some water and she gives her some water. But then he talks to her about living water and receiving eternal life. You know, it's a brilliant story with some epic parallels to stuff that happens in the Old Testament. But in John chapter 4, verses 16 to 18, it says, Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." Now Jesus knew this woman's history. He knew her past. He knew, you know, that she'd lived a bit of a checkered life, that she'd had a history with men, but he still wanted to talk to her. He still wanted her to talk to him. He was still looking for her to be honest with him. And then, incredibly, after this encounter and after this conversation that they had, he revealed his true character to her. He told her that he was the Christ. He told her that he was the Messiah that was prophesied, the one that she had been waiting for. You know, you can fool each other, we can, you know, pretend, or we can, you know, play a character. We can fool the doctors, we can fool counselors, but you can't fool God. You can't fool Jesus. You can't fool those who know us more than we know ourselves. We can downplay stuff to each other. We can downplay our feelings. We can hide from our true selves or pretend to be someone or something we're not. But we're only really going to get the true help we need when we let it all go and we let it all out. Jesus understands your struggles. He gets it. He understands it. He can relate to you. He will never be surprised by your struggles. He knows. He knows your past, he knows your present, and he knows your future. So talk. Number two, I guess in counselling you need to talk, but then you need to listen. The Bible describes an amazing story when Jesus takes three of his disciples up to a mountain and God spoke to them saying, it says in Mark 9 verses 7, "This is my son whom I love. Listen to him." Listen to him. Listen to Jesus. It also says in John 10 verses 27, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me." So how do we listen to what is being said? You know, this isn't rocket science this morning or today. This is, you know, stuff that we all know. But how do we listen? Read your Bible. You know, it's God's word to our lives, to our minds, to our hearts. Read it. It is God speaking to us through words. And God reveals new things to us. You know, if we've read something, you know, hundreds of times before, read it again, because it is a living word. God's word changes. God's word doesn't change, but how we see God's word, you know, changes our lives and how we look at it. It speaks to us differently. Pray. You know, God speaks to us through prayer. When we talk to Him, He responds. You know, prayer is an open conversation. There is a direct line to our Heavenly Father. So let's spend time, you know, in prayer. Let's spend time on our knees talking to God, but also listening to what He is trying to say to us. Surround yourself and speak to godly people, wise people, people who read, who know the Bible, people who know the Word of God. Surround yourself with people who pray, you know, people who are in tune with the Heavenly Father. And then that way, it's not just advice, it's not just somebody giving their opinion, it is somebody who is able to speak truth into your life because it is steeped in biblical truth. And somebody who is in tune with the Father can speak God's word into your life as well. You know, it says in John 16 verses 13 that the Spirit of truth will come. And when the Spirit of truth comes, He will guide you into all the truth. For He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He will speak. And He will declare to you the things that are to come. The Holy Spirit is living inside those who know and have accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. You know, listen to the Holy Spirit. Be guided by the Holy Spirit. You know, ask Him to talk to you and listen to what He's trying to say and reveal to us. So talk, listen, and then do. You know, sometimes counsellors suggest things to try that you might not like or that you might think is illogical. Will you trust Jesus enough to do what He says, even if it feels counter to what you want to do? In Matthew 19, we read about a rich man who asks Jesus, what must he do to get into heaven? And Jesus responds by saying, keep the law, keep the commandments. Which a young man, the rich man, said that he had done that. And then Jesus says, sell everything you have, then come follow me. You know, that story isn't about money, or it's not about riches, or it's not about wealth, or having nice stuff. The story is about the heart of the rich man and whether he's willing to listen to, obey and trust Jesus over everything he has ever learned and achieved and acquired up to that point in his life. And earlier in Matthew we read that Jesus was walking on the sea, or walking by the Sea of Galilee, and he saw brothers Peter and Andrew, fishermen, working. They were casting their nets, and Jesus said to them, follow me, I will make you fish for men. And it says, at once they left their nets and followed him. And then it says, Jesus saw two other brothers, James and John. They were sitting on a boat with their father. They were mending their nets. And Jesus called them. And again, at once they left their boats and their father and followed Jesus. Jesus says, if you love me, obey my commandments. And as you know, those that know me, one of my favourite books of the Bible is James. And in the first chapter, verse 22, James writes, do not merely listen to the word so deceive yourself. Do what it says. Why listen? Why do what our wonderful counsellor tells us to do? Because Jesus cares for you. You know, it says in Peter, cast your burdens onto him because he cares for you. He's not just waiting for the timer to count down on your hour-long appointment, or he's not just listening because he's being paid to listen. He's there because he cares about you as a person. He cares about your character. He cares about your feelings, your emotions, your thoughts, your health, your well-being. He cares about everything about you. And he cares because he loves you. How much do you pay him for a counseling session? Nothing. How much does he pay? Jesus paid with his blood. You know, why do we need a counselor? You know, for sick people. You know, are you sick? You know, you might not think so, but we are all messed up. We were all born into a messed up world. And we could decide that we don't need a counselor, We might decide that we know best and that our decisions are for our own good. And then, great, but to be honest, I think history has shown that I don't always make the best choices. When I choose to do things in my own strength and go my own direction and rely on my own wisdom, then pretty soon I realise that I'm on the wrong road. By relying on your feelings, following your heart, or trusting in your gut, you're putting your faith and your confidence in something that is changeable and relies on that specific moment in time. Isaiah is promising a wonderful, beautiful, glorious, perfect counsellor. This is who Jesus is. He is the one who helps us as we humble ourselves before him. This is God in the flesh, counselling, leading, directing our lives, all of our decisions, according to that which is good and right. The core of our sinfulness in our hearts is our tendency to choose our own way over God's way, our own wisdom over God's wisdom, as if we know better than him. And so Jesus, God in the flesh, is our wonderful counsellor who comes to show us that his ways are better than our ways. His thoughts are better than our thoughts. His wisdom is far higher, better, greater than our own wisdom. In Luke 5, verses 31, Jesus says, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." Jesus didn't come to make bad people good, but he came to make dead people alive. In Isaiah 55, it says, "Jesus took our crown of thorns. Jesus accepted the nails in his hands. He took the punishment. He stood between the law for us at a great price. And now he calls us to come to him, to turn to the counsellor, this wonderful counsellor. His plans are perfect. His ways are not always what you expect, but they're always gracious and good, full of delight. In him, you will find peace, strength, direction, freedom, and if you need it, you will find eternal life."